We are now seeing the beginnings of another stage of human evolution.
Are mutants dangerous?
Child.
What are you doing here?
Mutants are very real. And they are among us.
Why do you ask questions to which you already know the answers? Don't give up on them, Eric.
Don't get in my way.
We've managed to gather evidence of a mutant training facility.
What do you need, William?
Just your authorization for special operation.
He wanted Cerebro.
This device amplifies my power, allowing me to locate mutants across great distances.
The extermination has already begun. Make no mistake, my brothers.
You know, Magneto's right. There's a war coming. Are you sure you're on the right side?
Eric, what have you done? What have you told Stryker? Everything.
Those people down there, they control our fate and the fate of every other mutant.
Our God will be there. Normal people.
Tell me, where is Magneto?
Can't you read my mind? You have more power than you can imagine.
Will it be for the greater good, or will it be used for destructive ends?
Whatever are you looking for?
I'm looking for hope.
X-Men, one of the best and biggest comic series of all time, lasting on printed page for over 40 years, spawning numerous spin-off titles, more than a few animated adventures, one of which ran for an impressive 5 seasons and is regarded as one of the best cartoons of the 90s. Also several toy lines as well as general merchandise, and one of the longest running film franchises in its genre. Akin to its comic book counterpart, the popularity of the original X-Men film created a franchise which has expanded exponentially in the past 16 years, with sequels, prequels, and spin-offs. This uncanny franchise shows no signs of slowing down anytime soon.
Tell me where your fucking boss is, or you're gonna die in 5 minutes!
Though the X-Men are currently commonplace in theaters across the world every few years, back in the mid-80s into the 90s, there were a few failed attempts to bring the X-Men to the big screen, one of which would have seen James Cameron of Terminator fame as producer and Catherine Bigelow of Point Break fame as director, with Bob Hoskins as Wolverine and Angela Bassett as Storm. Who knows what might have been, but Destiny had bigger plans for the X-Men, and as history now knows, timing was everything.
You haven't told him about his past.
Who was he?
I can't remember.
Sometimes anger can help you survive.
The war has begun.
Marvel Comics X-Men, created by writer Stan Lee and artist Jack Kirby in 1963, are a group of student heroes led by Professor Charles Xavier. Professor X, as he's affectionately referred to by his students, is a powerful mutant telepath who teaches young mutants to use their abilities for the betterment of mankind by fighting for peaceful coexistence in a world where bigotry against mutants is fiercely rampant. Though creative forces on the X-Men title have changed throughout the decades, the aforementioned theme has remained intact. As the title changed through the years, so did its colorful cast of heroes and villains. Although Xavier's original first class of X-Men consisted of Cyclops, Marvel Girl, Iceman, Angel, and the Beast battling militant mutant terrorist Magneto, director Bryan Singer's X-Men retains the use of Professor X, optic energy blasting Scott Summers, Cyclops, telepath Jean Grey, who's never referred to as Marvel Girl, elemental Bobby Drake, Iceman, who hasn't graduated to full-fledged X-Men yet, and pulls from the cast of the all-new, all-different X-Men of the 1970s to make up the rest of the team's roster. With weather-controlling Aurora Monroe, Storm, rapid-healing adamantium-clawed Wolverine, a.k.a. Logan, along with 80s fan favorite power-absorbing Rogue, aka Marie. Original drafts of the script also featured Hank McCoy Beast, but was cut due to budgetary concerns. The X-Men battle Magneto and his Brotherhood of Mutants, consisting of shape-shifting Mystique, animalistic Sabretooth, and acrobatic Toad. Though the changes are made for the X-Men's transition from page to screen, the film interpretation respects the aforementioned theme of peaceful coexistence, depicted in the source material. Anti-mutant activist Senator Robert Kelly's newly proposed Mutant Registration Act is close to enactment, which will force mutants to expose their identities and abilities publicly to a society that mostly hates and fears them. Professor X and Eric Langsher, not Eric Magnus as he's named in the original X-Men comics, are at odds over conflicting ideologies concerning human-mutant relations. Xavier's belief of peaceful coexistence is in exact opposition to Magneto's belief of mutant supremacy. Magneto plans to transform humans into mutants with a device powered by his magnetic abilities. However, using the machine almost kills him during test stages. His attempt to serve up poetic justice by turning Senator Kelly into a mutant failed to have the desired effect, unbeknownst to Magneto. So he kidnaps Rogue in an attempt to use her absorption power to absorb his ability to power the device and sacrifice her for the greater good of his cause. When the X-Men learn of Magneto's plans from a dying Senator Kelly, they race to the scene in their tricked-out stealth jet, the Blackbird, to have a deadly showdown with the Brotherhood of Mutants on Liberty Island. Though I prefer the individual colorful costumes worn by their contemporary comic book counterparts, the black leather uniforms in the film are a nice modernized nod to the yellow and blue spandex uniforms worn by the team in the 1960s comic. A similar version of the film adaptation's uniforms debuted in the ongoing retitled New X-Men number 114, written by Grant Morrison and illustrated by Frank Quitely.
Do I actually go outside in these things?
What would you prefer, yellow spandex?
Before an X-Men film was ever even close to production, Patrick Stewart has always been a fan favorite for the role of Charles Xavier, and Stewart does not disappoint in the least. Stewart is tailor fit to play Xavier, not just his strong resemblance to his comic book counterpart, but he truly captures the essence of the character. Xavier's poise, intellect, and genuine belief in his fellow mutants and humanity's potential unity. Sir Ian McLaren's portrayal of Magneto perfectly contrasts Stewart's Xavier. The pair work extremely well during respective scenes, but excel whenever on screen together.
Doesn't it ever wake you in the middle of the night? The feeling that someday they will pass that foolish law
and come for you and your children. Take you all away.
It does indeed. Swell of pity for the poor soul who comes to that school looking for trouble.
Stewart and McLaren brought a respectability to the film at a time when comic book-based films hadn't been taken seriously since 1989's Batman. Director Tim Burton's Batman legitimized the genre as a viable source for big-screen adaptations, with its adult themes and dark approach. Ironically, 8 years later, the fourth installment, Batman and Robin, almost destroyed that legitimacy, with its campy tone and kid-friendly approach. However, X-Men, along with Vampire Hunter Blade, returned the genre to its former cinematic glory by focusing on complex characters and re-exploring adult, darker themes, re-legitimizing the genre and paving the way for the Spider-Man trilogy and the onslaught of superhero films that followed, which continue to flourish today.
Thank you.
seminal part of Wolverine turned out to be a star-making role for relatively unknown Australian actor Hugh Jackman, after the part was turned down by international film star Russell Crowe. Jackman wholeheartedly embraced the role and has acquired a genuine love and respect for the character he's played for over 15 years in 8 relating X-Men films, as well as an equal respect for fans of the character. His enthusiasm to portray Wolverine definitely translates well to film, and he's become as synonymous with Wolverine as Robert Downey Jr. is with Iron Man. The only gripe from hardcore devotees of Wolverine is that compared to his comic book counterpart, Jackman is too tall. Rogue, usually depicted visually as very sexually charged as well as physically formidable, with her absorption power, indestructibility, and flight capabilities, undergoes drastic alterations from the source material, only retaining her comic book counterpart's involuntary ability to absorb another person's physical strength or superpowers, and sometimes their personality traits. Played by young Anna Paquin, with an engaging vulnerability and the appropriate amount of teen angst the film interpretation calls for. The film's main focus is on the aforementioned players, suffering a bit from trying to juggle too many characters. Halle Berry as Storm, James Marsden as Cyclops, and Femke Janssen as Jean Grey are well suited for their respective roles and are utilized well during pivotal action scenes, which showcase their individual powers. Yet the story accomplishes little by way of character development for the three. There is an intriguing love triangle that's focused upon between Cyclops, Jean Grey, and Wolverine that's a story element plucked from the X-Men comics, but isn't as fully explored. Besides Magneto, the rest of the Brotherhood of Mutants suffer even more for the same lack of attention. However, Ray Park as Toad, Rebecca Romaine Stamos as Mystique, and Tyler Mane as Sabretooth are also well suited for their roles, and deserve extra credit for spending hours upon hours in makeup chairs preparing for their parts.
It was like 2/3 of my body covered in prosthetics and the rest was all airbrushed. When I first took this on, they told me it would take 10 hours.
6 hours.
10 hours.
Amid superpower battles, special effects, and leather uniforms, at the heart of Bryan Singer's X-Men lies a message of peaceful coexistence with people of all kinds, regardless of race, gender, or religion. Despite minor nitpicks, X-Men manages to deliver a faithful film adaptation of the comic and is an accomplished first installment. Its superior sequel, X2, does a better job of balancing multiple characters than its predecessor and expands on themes established in the original, as well as the scope of the war between humans and mutants.
Since the discovery of their existence, mutants have been regarded with fear, suspicion, often hatred. Are they the next link in the evolutionary chain, or simply a new species of humanity fighting for their share of the world?
Also directed by Bryan Singer, X2 continues Xavier's quest to fulfill his dream of peace between mutants and humans. This time around, Xavier's dream of peaceful coexistence is further complicated by the arrival of Colonel William Stryker, who brainwashes and questions the imprisoned Magneto about the professor's mutant locating machine Cerebro. Stryker attacks the X-Mansion and brainwashes Xavier into locating every mutant on the planet, attempting to kill them. The X-Men must team up with the Brotherhood to prevent Stryker's worldwide genocide. And the team-up so well executed, the interplay between characters is extremely entertaining. There are a few welcome additions to the existing ensemble cast. Alan Cumming gives an engaging performance as devoted Catholic acrobatic teleporter Kurt Wagner, Nightcrawler. Kelly Ho gives a solid performance as the rapid healing adamantium clawed Lady Deathstrike. and Aaron Stanford nicely portrays the antisocial, fire-controlling
next
pirate.
Time if you like showing off. Don't.
There's also a cameo from fan favorite Colossus. Though he doesn't have a Russian accent, and he's not as buff as his comic book counterpart, his appearance is still a lot of fun. X-Men that were less prominent in the first installment are given a bit more to do this time around, with the exception of Cyclops, who spends most of his time a captive of Stryker, which is unfortunate because he's the X-Men's leader, and his banter with Wolverine, which worked so well in the original film, is sadly underutilized due to his lack of involvement.
Hey, it's me.
Prove it.
You're a dick.
Okay.
On the other end of the spectrum, per the popularity of his character, Wolverine steals the show as usual. The film was almost rated R due to some violent scenes featuring Wolverine. The scenes were trimmed and the film received the more favorable PG-13 rating. Fans have always wanted a grittier version of the character, a more definitive translation from page to screen that would warrant an R rating. And if the reports come to fruition, an R-rated Wolverine film is in production and will be released in the coming years. Logan's origins continue to be shrouded in mystery, as he still struggles with having no memories of his past prior to 15 years. Though it's revealed that Stryker is connected to his past and is responsible for his adamantium-laced bones, and may hold the key to unlocking his past, Logan realizes he has a place among the X-Men, and comes to terms with the loss of his memories. Just when you thought Mystique couldn't be any more badass, as she's portrayed in the first installment, she kicks more ass in one scene than in the entirety of the first film. The romance that was sparked in the previous outing between Iceman and Rogue gets a bit more development, as they pursue their courtship with the added difficulty of little physical contact, because of Rogue's mutant ability. The team's detour at Iceman's parents' house while trying to reunite with Storm and Jean Grey give some well-executed insight into how mutants are perceived.
So, when did you first know you were a
mutant?
But you cut that out.
You have to understand, we thought Bobby was going to a school for the gifted.
Bobby is gifted.
We know that. We just didn't realize
he was... We still love you, Bobby. It's just this mutant problem is a little...
What mutant problem?
Complicated.
What exactly are you professor of, Mr. Logan?
Art.
Well, you should see what Bobby can do.
Bobby. I can do a lot more than that.
Actually, they discovered that males are the ones who carry the mutant gene and pass it on, so it's his fault.
Oh, it's for me.
Bobby. Have you tried not being a mutant?
The death of Jean Grey is handled with extreme care. Those that only have a general association with the characters may not be as engaged because Cyclops spends most of his time outside of the love triangle he's supposed to be involved in along with Jean and Logan. But those that are long-term X-Men comics enthusiasts have an established connection, making her death and Scott and Logan's reaction all the more heartbreaking. The outpour of emotion from James Marsden and Hugh Jackman during the scene is touching to say the least. X2 fits into the rare category of sequels that are better than the original, and still holds up against many of its contemporary big screen counterparts. Jean Grey's death was intended to set up a screen adaptation of the very ambitious Dark Phoenix saga storyline, written by Chris Claremont and illustrated by John Byrne, which could have been epic in scale and may have lent itself to being left on a cliffhanger being told in two parts, as its original tale is too grand to be told in a single film. Who knows what might have been. However, the film delivered, X-Men Last Stand, isn't bad, but is nowhere near as well executed as the first two. Director Brian Singer's departure from the series may have had a hand in the film not being so well received as previous installments. Matthew Vaughn, who later went on to revitalize the X-Men franchise with the prequel First Class, was second in line to direct, but also departed due to personal reasons. Director Brett Ratner stepped up to a very difficult task, with some very big shoes to fill. X-Men The Last Stand isn't a complete failure, but unfortunately pales in comparison to the high standard of quality set by X2. Though there are elements of the Dark Phoenix saga incorporated into the story, those elements also pale in comparison to the source materials. The film's version of the story begins with the resurrection of Jean Grey, with a reemergence of a dormant alternate personality, the Dark Phoenix, suppressed long ago by Professor X. The rest of the film's story's focus is on a mutant cure, which is very loosely based on the Gifted storyline from Astonishing X-Men series, written by Josh Whedon and illustrated by John Cassaday.
Your flesh peeled and roasted.
The hostage situation in the Chapman building, but the FBI...
Time to make nice with the public. We have to astonish them.
We have found a cure.
Team Xavier's quest for mutant and human equality continues to clash with Team Magneto's fight for mutant supremacy. The invention of a weaponized cure further complicates matters. The core of the ensemble cast reunite, with additional new mutants played by fresh talent. Kelsey Grammer as the animalistic Secretary of Mutant Affairs Hank McCoy, Beast. Ellen Page as matter-phasing Kitty Pryde, Shadowcat. Daniel Cudmore as Peter Rasputin, Colossus, who has the ability to transform his skin into organic steel, and Ben Foster as the high-flying, winged Warren Worthington III, the Angel, all collectively siding with the X-Men. While Dana Ramirez as leader of the Omegas, Callisto, Eric Dane as self-copying James Maddox, the Multiple Man, and Vinnie Jones as the unstoppable Kane Marco, the Juggernaut, join with the Brotherhood. Though each character is changed in some way or another from their comic book counterparts, Juggernaut is the standout. The source material's version isn't a mutant at all. His power is derived from a mystical gem, and he's not some random villain. He's actually the stepbrother of Professor X. However different, Vinnie Jones is well suited for the role. Perhaps more attention to the aforementioned storyline and less attention to introducing new characters may have resulted in a more cohesive narrative.
The air is still, and the night has fallen. There's only one question you must answer. Who will you stand with?
Kelsey Grammer gives an exceptional performance as Beast, a quick-witted intellectual and feral combatant, a perfect representation of his comic book counterpart. More fan service is served up with a fastball special made famous in the X-Men comics by Wolverine and Colossus during a Danger Room session.
Class dismissed.
But just as well as some characters are portrayed, others are portrayed just as poorly. For instance, Mystique is set up in the beginning of the film to be just as badass as she is in the previous films.
Let me out of here! I demand that you release me. Do you know who I am? I'm the President of the United States.
Oh, Mr. President.
Shut up!
Why are you doing this to me? Let me down. I'll be a good girl. Please let me go. Please.
Keep it up. I'll spray you in the face, bitch.
When I get out of here, I'm gonna kill you myself.
Yeah, right.
But then she's given the shaft to make room for less appealing characters like Callisto and Pyro. Rogue seeks out the cure and disappears from the film and doesn't return till the very end. Angel is seemingly set up to be an integral part of the story at the beginning of the film, but also disappears, until he swoops in for the end battle to rescue his father, who's an advocate and funder of the cure. Cyclops takes a backseat yet again, with a role diminished to glorified cameo, with his character being killed off in the first 15 minutes of the film. Professor X and Jean Grey are also killed off. Though the death of Jean Grey is handled well and is an emotionally charged scene, After seeing Cyclops and Xavier die earlier, as well as other disservices, the film loses any momentum it was trying to build to its end game. Also, most fans would agree that after giving the lion's share of attention to Wolverine in previous films, the third time around the focus could have been on the X-Men as a team, instead of basically giving him an even bigger role as team leader. Though technically the job is Storm's, Wolverine's the only one giving inspirational speeches.
Yeah, we're outnumbered. I'm not gonna lie to you. But we lost Scott. We lost a professor. If we don't fight now, everything they stood for will die with them. I'm not gonna let that happen. Are you? Then we stand together. X-Men. All of us.
And barking orders.
You men, come at the doors! Everybody get together! And hold this line!
The misdeeds in X-Men 3 The Last Stand are later made up for with Bryan Singer's triumphant return to the franchise with X-Men Days of Future Past, just as much a sequel to X3 as it is to X-Men First Class. It's a time travel story which alters the timeline, resulting in the return of formerly deceased characters. Overall, the X-Men trilogy as a whole is worth investing 6 hours in, despite its finality shortcomings.
...to arrive about an hour ago, greeted with a sort of garden party atmosphere, which was designed to entertain them as the others traversed the rigid security.
For more X-Men reviews, click the links below for our comic book movie flashbacks of X-Men Origins Wolverine, X-Men First Class, and X-Men Days of Future Past. Always remember to let your geek flag fly with Mad About Superheroes. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment down below. Thanks for tuning in. suited for the role. Perhaps more attention to the aforementioned storyline and less attention to introducing new characters may have resulted in a more cohesive narrative.